pray, and then we're going to jump right in because this message is kind of odd to me because it's for me. You guys just get to be here because you're supposed to be here at 8 o'clock. So let's go ahead and pray together, and then I'm just going to chew apart myself for about the next hour, and if you want to join along, that's great. Dear Heavenly Father, I do thank you so much for this morning. Father, I thank you for what you've blessed us with. I know we just came out of Thanksgiving, Father, but that should be a time for us every day. Father, I do thank you that you give me an opportunity to preach because it scares me to death. And Father, usually when that happens, it's because I need to be changed. And Father, I pray this message would change me. Father, I pray that it would change the heart of someone in this room that I doubt you gave it just for me because I'm not worth a whole lot, Father. But there's a room full of people here whose lives could be changed by this. So Father, please help us to understand it. Please help me to be calm in presenting it because it's about to wind me up like I've never been wound up before. So Father, please bless this message. Hide me behind the cross. Tuck me behind it, Father. Stand above me. Anoint me again to preach. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. I had to pray first because I'm going to talk about a kind of interesting subject. Dumb people. That's why I'm talking about me. I think it's interesting that we just came out of Thanksgiving and the first thing that popped in my head whenever I was trying to figure out what I'm going to preach about was dumb people. And it's not because my family is full of dumb people. It's just because you generally run into those kind of people at this time of year, especially the day after Thanksgiving, which is the most insane time of year. And I absolutely think it's comical to watch people elbow each other for an Xbox or fight over a waffle iron. I think it's amazing. And while I was doing some research on this, and I have to mention this before I go any further, I stink at providing information for my sermons. So when Jeff was asking me what it's about, I gave him like the bare minimum. I gave him the title, which is just what sin. Yeah, that's a whole real explanation when you're going to put a service together. And then I got a text message from him, my wife did last night. We didn't see it till late last night. And he kind of mentioned that there were several songs and he wasn't sure how it was going to all tie together. And it's going to fit beautifully. And I love when God does that because one of the songs Cheryl had asked, you know, if you had a song, what would you pick? And one of the specials we're going to be blessed with has an entire passage out of the song that I was thinking of. So it's amazing how this all works together. But back to the dumb people. There have been researchers who have spent the last several years, I was researching this weekend from Princeton University, who've been trying to answer the question that my father knew the answer to from forever. Why do smart people do dumb things? Why is it that you can watch somebody get into a situation which to you from the outside looks absolutely commonplace, and they just mess it up? You'll see brilliant minds do dumb things. You'll see situations where you just say, duh, this is the answer. How is it so hard for you to get? And yet you'll see the most brilliant minds in all of history have these moments where they just can't make a common sense decision. My father used to call it being book smart with no common sense, and he used to tell that to me all the time. There was one instance I was thinking of this weekend that we were sitting there and we were getting ready to build this barn. And my dad is just sitting there, and I ask him what the problem is. He's trying to figure out how big to make this thing and how to figure out how to make a 60 by 40 barn square. And me and my brilliance of algebra say, Dad, the Pythagorean theorem, to which my dad, who only went to eighth grade, had no idea what I was talking about. And I managed to explain how we can measure the diagonals and put this thing perfectly within square. And then he asks me for a hammer, and I can't remember what it is. I go over there and I'm looking at the box. He says, a hammer, son. And I just stood there for a second. For some reason, I had lost my complete train of thought. The most common tool that any man should ever understand is a hammer because you fix everything with it. And I couldn't pick it up. My mind had completely went blank. Now, these researchers had spent tons and tons of time trying to figure out what it is. And then they started to rationalize it and they've started to make answers for it. And one of the theories that they have come up with why smart people do dumb things, they call it a blind spot bias. They call it this scenario where you are so close to the situation, you take shortcuts and you miss the point. I'm going to give you two examples, and I hope you're brighter than I was when I try to come up with them. I'm going to give you two questions they used on this questionnaire to see if you're smart. The first question, I'm not going to give you a lot of time to answer this because if I do, you'll figure it out. A ball and a bat sold together cost $1.10. And the bat costs $1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? How many people think the answer is 10 cents? Yeah, no. I had to actually think about it for a second, because if the ball costs 10 cents and the bat costs $1 more, then the bat would cost $1.10, and the answer can't be $1.10. It's a nickel. Here's the other question. This one got me for the second. My wife smiled because she missed the first one and just blew me away on the second one. There's a lake being covered by lily pads. It'll take 48 days to completely cover the lake, and it grows by half every day. How many days does it take to get to half of the lake? You see, in our minds, we immediately say, it doubles half, 24, 47, because it doubles every day. You see, most people take the mental shortcut and they go, okay, if it's a dollar more, take a dollar off. If it's double, then take half. You see, we take these shortcuts. It's not that we're incapable of really understanding. It's not that we're dumb. It's just that we don't see the whole situation. We don't take time to really figure it out. We just blast through this thing trying to find it. But the real problem isn't that we are incapable of always finding the right answer. It's that we're always capable of seeing everyone else get it wrong. That's the craziest thing in life. We are absolutely amazing at finding people doing the wrong things. Because when we get to that situation where we just have a duh moment, where we just can't pick up the hammer to save our life, everyone around us thinks it's the easiest thing in the world. For those of you who got the answer right for the nickel, gee, everyone else, this was a question you had to think about. To you, it was duh, this is an easy answer. To the 47, duh, this is an easy answer. But when we get to those places, what we don't understand is that we have got the same problems that other people have in those same moments. Because I love the fact that I happen to have more of those duh moments at work than anyone else I know. They assume that because you're a programmer, you never get anything wrong, and half the time I forget to answer things the way I should. Or I'll leave off entire words or phrases, or I'll write down a program and forget things out of the entire thing, because to me, I was going so fast trying to get the answer right enough that I got it all wrong and the thing won't work. But it's amazing when you have those moments where you get to point at other people and say, ha, duh, the answer's this. You get to give them that wonderful criticism they gave you, that this was so easy, how come you couldn't get it? Now, these researchers who spent all this time trying to figure this out, all this time, have come up with the theory of bias blind spot. What it basically means, in the simplest of terms, is that you've come to the place where you can see into a situation in someone else's life, and because you are not in that situation, you are not blinded by their bias, and the answer becomes easy to you. But your situation is different. Because you're in your own situation, and you have that blind spot, you cannot see, and you will rationalize away your wrongness. This is 2016. This is a Nobel Prize winning professor from Princeton, and I want to go to him and say, duh. Because in Matthew 7, we are met with the answer to this thousands of years before a brilliant professor figured this out, that if I've got a beam in my own eye, I can't see rightly to get the speck out of my brother's eye. But I don't even see the beam in my own eye because I'm so worried about the speck in my brother's. It took thousands of years and tons of research dollars for a professor to figure out what God has been telling us for the longest period of time. Smart people do dumb things. They get so caught up in themselves that they forget that they have their own problems. And this flaw in us, this inability to see things, is really more systematic of our entire lives. And I know that it was just this cute little science lesson about how our brains work, but there's something deeper here, something real that we need to understand. Because the reason we can't see things is because we really do have that blind spot to ourselves. And this is now beyond the ability to actually see. This has nothing to do with thinking errors. This has a spiritual blindness in us. You see, we walk around like dumb people sometimes. We fail to see, we fail to understand what the real problem is. It's not that we're so smart, we're dumb. It's that we can't see what's wrong in us, but we're very quick to see what's wrong in other people. I'm very quick to laugh at the people who will fight over these things the day after Thanksgiving, and yet I desire things just like anyone else. He's right, though. I mean, not just the Bible. The Bible is always right, but this professor is right that it is so hard for us to see what's in ourselves. It's so hard for us to understand these things. But I need us to understand them, because I need to understand them. I need to understand the answer to the question I've asked God thousands of times over in my life, because I'm blind. What's sin? What has done this? What is doing this to me? What sin, Father? I taught the youth a couple weeks ago on Wednesday night. We hung out in the book of Job. If you want to have fun with some teenagers, hang out in the book of Job, because it's just this fun mess of stuff when they really just look confused that Job's just doing nothing and God is having a conversation with the devil, because they don't think that ever happens. And here's the God meeting with the devil twice and having a conversation and picking on this poor man named Job. But my favorite part in the entire story of Job is not the end of it where God just comes down and just chews Job out saying, where were you? My favorite passage in the entire thing is when Job's caring, compassionate friends show up, look at Job and all of his mess. Look at Job sitting there scraping himself with sores, looking at him just sitting there with absolutely everything falling apart around him, and just look at him and say, what have you done, Job? My best friends, what have you done, Job? They asked Job the same question, what sin? And Job answers, what sin? You see, we don't have the luxury so often that Job had where we're living in a situation where God has just decided to test our faith. God has decided to see whether or not we understand we really are his. So often it's because we really are blind. So often we really are asking that question, what sin? We live our lives in such a way where when people see us, when we're in the middle of being chastised for our sin, or we're facing the consequences of our sin, or maybe somebody just comes to us concerned about our sin, and we ask the question, what sin? Because we become blind to what we're doing. We become blind to the things going on this morning, and we need to understand them. To be honest with you this morning, I need to understand them. When I go before God, when I fall on my knees in prayer before the Almighty Creator of all the earth, and I ask the question, what sin? I need the answer. Because it's what's keeping me from being where I ought to be. It's what's holding me back in my life. It's what's caused me to have anger or jealousy or malice. There's this thing that's blocking me, and it's what sin, Father? But an awful lot of time when God's trying to talk to me about it, I'm looking at him going, what sin? What have I done? So that's the question we need to ask this morning. We're going to keep asking it over and over as we walk through not just our perspective of it, but God's. What sin? What sin? And it has chased us throughout all of history. I love the fact that the Bible is the origin of so many things. And one of my favorite things it's the origin of is the game, Not It. The very beginning. You can you imagine being Adam? You have been created out of nothingness. You have fellowship with the God of all things. He in his infinite wisdom decides you need a companion, and he makes a woman. That's the coolest thing ever, because she's not like me. She's absolutely opposite, and that is way better, and I like the fact that she's different than me. And he makes her, and then he's walking in the garden, and he gives him one rule, and then all of a sudden God comes to talk to Adam, and he invents the game, Not It, Not Me. Because he understands what he has done, God comes and asks the basic question, and this is the paraphrased version for this sermon, what's sin? And Adam answers, what's sin? Not me. You gave me her, and she did it. And she points to the serpent, you created this thing, and he did it. I love this. There's only one person in this entire situation that did what he was trying to do, and that's the serpent. The rest of them have no idea what's going on, but they're pointing the finger at everyone else. I mean, I can't imagine being Adam. You are in perfection. You are in the place where everything is perfect. You are talking to the Almighty Creator of all things, who breathed life into a pile of dust and named it Adam, and then made you go to sleep, and he made a woman out of part of you. He made a whole woman out of a piece of me. Imagine if he took the whole arm. I mean, good night, what he could have made. He took just a rib and poof, here comes a woman. He made all of this. This was my gift to completion, and you did it. It was you. You made her and she did this. Can you even imagine the audacity of talking to Almighty God and being like, well, if you wouldn't have given me her, I didn't do it, not me. What's in her? Yell at her for this. My whole life, I'm the only boy in my house. I tried that all the time. It never worked. I was always in trouble if it broke. And if my sisters cried, I got in trouble because they would hit me and then fall on the ground crying. I got the brunt of it. And I was always asking, what did I do? You see, Adam's asking the same question. Well, what did I do? He knows the answer. He hid from God. He knew what had happened. He was smart enough now to know that that rule was serious. And when God said, I'm going to surely die, I'm going to surely die. And it chased him the rest of his life. I used to have a grandpa who used to talk about the golden days of yore, you know, when you walked 10 miles uphill both ways in the snow, but you were happy about it because you were going to school, and taxes were lower, and hamburgers cost a nickel. My grandpa was always telling stories about 1942. Apparently, 1942 was a really great year. It was always back in 42. I don't know what happened to him then, but it was amazing because he didn't meet my grandma until 1943, but something happened, and maybe it was the last year of freedom. He's like, back in 42, things were great. And I wonder if Adam was like that. You know, when they're plowing the field and, you know, Seth's over there going, man, this just stinks. Well, son, you know, back in the good old days, the ground was so soft you could plow it with your toe and there were no weeds and everything was great. I imagine they got tired of hearing that. If that's how Adam was, or maybe every time the great-great-grandson number 347 came to him with a splinter in his finger, he remembered the time there were those. Or when he saw his great-great-great-great-grandsons come in from the field, sunburned, he remembered before that happened. He remembered that time when he looked at the Almighty God and said, what sin? What a... You see, it chased them, though. And it's chased them through all of history. You skip ahead a whole bunch of years and you get into David, and David writes this beautiful song in Psalm 53 where he laments the fact that we have fallen into a wicked generation who does not even know that they have gone into wickedness. They are so blinded by what they've become, they don't even understand what they've fallen into. David sees it. David, who was not in any means perfect, understood that they are a fallen people. You see, David was really great at finding other people's sins. It took someone coming and accusing him before he realized his own. But David saw it. He saw it in all the people around him, but he was blind to his own. Then you jump just a little further ahead, and when his son Solomon, the wisest man on earth who thought 1,000 women would be a good idea, is praying and dedicating the temple in 1 Kings chapter 13, I think it is. He prays and implores the people to watch out for your iniquities. Watch out, because if you go aside, captivity will come. And just a few chapters later, it says that Solomon's wives carried away his heart. You see, Solomon was wise enough to look out at all the people and see, these people are going to mess this thing up, but I'm pretty good. But he didn't even see what was going on in his own life. Because what part of you thinks that I have a hard time keeping one happy? Why do you have 1,000? And how do you even manage that? I mean, can you imagine 1,000? You better just marry them all on the same day. Because anniversaries would just be a nightmare. But he couldn't see these things. And I think it's interesting. There's an interesting poet. And if you've been to college, you've probably heard of him. His name is Alfred Lord Tennyson. He gave us such great pearls of wisdom as... it is better to have loved and lost than to never have loved at all. And from the poem, The Charge of the Life Brigade, we get a modification of what we now say, ours is but to do and die. Ours is not to question why, ours is but to do and die. He wrote it, theirs is not to question why, but theirs is to do and die. But he also gave us this amazing pearl of wisdom. Sin is too stupid to see beyond itself. I love that. He writes these epic things and he just bluntly tells us the point of sin. Sin is too stupid to see beyond itself. And it's so true. Because here you are with the wisest man who God has ever blessed the earth with, who has been given all forms of wisdom, who I don't even understand his book of Proverbs sometimes. This guy's wisdom is so wise, the wise don't even understand it. It's just going on about things. And in the same breath that he writes, who am I to say that I have made my heart clean, that I am pure from my sin, is also the one whom God writes later on, his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God. Solomon, who can look out and say, none of us are smart enough to see the depths of our sin. And God reveals that to Solomon, yet Solomon doesn't take the time to look in and see that his own heart is impure with God. You see, we're too stupid to see beyond the things around us. And I apologize if that's a bad word. It is in my house. My kids are going to chastise me for it later. Dad, you said it like 5 times. But that's the reality of things. You see, these smart people who do dumb things, these answers that seem easy to you, but everyone else seems to miss them, and sometimes it's things that everyone else gets you can't seem to understand, is because sin makes us too dumb to see beyond ourselves. That beam is a beam because it's so close to my eye that it's blocking my vision. It does not mean he had a log sticking out of his eye. It means perspectively, because it's in my eye, it seems huge. I used to play this game when I was a little kid. I saw it on a TV show one time, where when I would get mad at people, I would go like this and start squishing in their heads. Because to me, my hand is huge. Because it was all a point of perspective. I didn't have a ginormous hand that could crush people. It was because it was perspective. It was close to me. You see, this thing in our eye, this sin that catches us, is so close to us, so right here, that it blocks out a significant piece of my vision. I got a motorcycle and I absolutely love riding it, but it has started to fog up in the helmet because it's getting cold. So that by the time I get home, or by the time I get to work or home, either way, I've got about right here. which makes it really nerve-wracking when people are coming on and off the highway, because all you see is right here. And when you turn your head and the wind catches you, it feels like you're going to fly off the bike. So all you have is right here, and everything has become blind. My kids asked me this weekend, there was a similar question. My kids asked me, what are blinders on a horse? I love when God is just answering things for me whenever I'm just trying to figure this out. They had no idea what message I'm writing. And my daughter goes, what are blinders and what do they do? I'm like, are you kidding me? You put them on a horse so they don't see all the distractions around them. They only see what you want them to see. You see what our sin has done to us. It doesn't want you to see the greater picture. I want you to look right here. Focus on this thing. Focus on this desire you have. Focus right here on this thing. Don't catch up on all this other stuff God wants you to know. Don't catch up on all these things. Focus right here. I don't want you to see all the hurt you're causing. I don't want to see the wake you're creating. Focus right here. It is blinding them. And Solomon, all of his wisdom, is being blinded by this thing. But then you can leap forward again in history and go all the way to Isaiah. Isaiah, who writes that we have all been led like lambs to the slaughter, that we have all caused our sin, that we have all have this thing in front of us, that we are all filthy. You jump ahead and he says, all of your righteousness is as filthy rags. All of it is destructive. It has carried you away like a wind, and God has hidden his face from you. He used to walk with Adam, and he's hidden his face from me. What happened? What sin? What have I done? But that's the Old Testament. You know, that's the olden days of yore, right? God is now he just loves people. He just wants to love on you. He just wants everybody to get to heaven, sit around the cosmic campfire and sing Kumbaya with him. That's just God now. He just loves you. He doesn't want anything to happen to you. He doesn't care about the sin thing. He just loves people. Except for when you get into the New Testament, Romans tells us that the wages of sin is death. We went from he has separated us, he's hiding his face, to you're going to die in this. And not only are you going to die in this, but you might be saying, well, he's going to die in it. That guy is messed up. He's saying there is none righteous. And as you jump all the way into John, in 1 John, he goes so far as to saying, if you would dare to say that you have not sinned, not only are you making God a liar, but the truth of God does not lie in you. You have gotten to the place where you can't even see it, and you are trying to call God a liar. You are all covered by this thing. You are all consumed by this wickedness. It is completely covering you. Sin has destroyed it. What's sin? All of it. But we have that bias blind spot where we marginalize it, or we rationalize it. It's like that child with the chocolate cake smeared all over his face looking at you and saying, what cake? Well, there is none. Now I ate it. What cake? It's gone. But we rationalize away. We try to hide these things away. We try to attach emotion and circumstances. We measure it. We lay it out. We try to figure out how it's not our fault. My house is a difficult house to live in, I'll admit it. And my kids probably have it harder than some people because I got raised by my father that things were either right or wrong, black or white, left or right. There is no middle road. So messing up a little bit was enough to be punished for all of it. And they've tasted that because their father lives almost by the same thing, that things are just the way they are. And it irritates me beyond no end when they try to rationalize away what they've done wrong. And some brilliant minds have said the things that irritate us the most are the things that are in yourself, and I do it with God all the time. I rationalize away why it's not my fault. There were situations in my life that led me here. There were things that got me here. My dad didn't hug me enough. My mom never did. My friends weren't the right friends. You didn't give me enough money. All of these things are not my fault. I would rationalize these things with God. I would argue them on why they're not me. And I would say, what sin? I would go before God and say, what sin? And he would answer, that little white lie, that extra 5 miles an hour, the fact that you omitted, the test that you cheated on, that extra look you took, that channel you didn't change, that word you shouldn't have said, that laughter you shouldn't have given, that fantasy, that thought, that lying, that cheating, that jealousy, that anger, that malice, that wrath, everything in you that's wrong, every one of them. I would ask God, what sin? And he would say all of them. I would ask God, what sin? And he would point to every single one. I would ask him, what nailed me? What nailed him to the cross? What did this? And he would say, every one of them. Because I would try to say some didn't matter. I would try to argue that some didn't ruin you. You see, I would ask, what's sin? And any question would actually have to be further laid out and say, what sin ruins? You see, I always ask the question, well, what's sin? God says, what does sin ruin? And you see, it's everything about us. It's everything in us. It's that thing inside of us that absolutely ruins us. And I would ask you the question, what doesn't sin ruin? Can you think of one instance where jealousy helped? One instance where lying helped? One instance where cheating helped? One instance where adultery helped? One instance where killing helped somebody? One instance where everything that was wrong with us? One instance where my wrath helped? One instance where cheating on the test helped? One instance where lying to the boss helped? One instance where speeding really helped? Ask the question, where that drink helped? Ask where that drug helped? Ask God, where did my falseness help? Name one time your sin helped. Because I would ask you, it is always not helping. I would ask you the question, why do you think it can help? It was what drove Adam from the garden. It's what changed life forever. It is what has caused death beyond death from the beginning to the end. It will what leads to the last death of my great-great-grandchild. It is the thing that killed my great-great-grandfather. It is what will cause everything to fall. What sin? What does sin ruin? All of it. Every piece of it. That word mar is this beautiful thing that means to spoil or rot. I love when they're just these beautiful words that just really go deeper than what we think they do. When we moved into our house, before we moved into our house, I had this freezer full of meat. It was wonderful. I just love meat. And there was this giant pile of meat in a freezer. So I brought it into the house because I had nowhere else to put it. Big full freezer of meat. Put it in the house, plugged it in, and decided to go home. Well, Cheryl left after me. And I didn't tell her I put this freezer in there, so she unplugged it. Or she turned off the breaker and everything went dark. We didn't work on the house for a week in July. I came back and opened the door and immediately knew something was wrong. You know that smell of rotten meat that's just been festering for a week in the hot July sun. It was the nastiest smell I've ever smelled, and we barely got it out of the house before we moved in, and my wife probably thinks I'm crazy, but I swear I can still smell it in that freezer. This is like 9 years later, and we used a lot of baking soda, but I swear it's still there. It rots and it ruins. And our sin is that same deep stink on us. We ask the question, what sin? While that stink is rising to heaven, and God says all of it. Every bit of it. Now, up to this point, I've really just been talking about mine. And I've really just been talking about sin in general. But here's the crazy thing. Here's where God really just pounded on me this week. That's my perspective. That's how I see it. Because that's how God has instructed me to see sin. I ask the question, what's sin? Because I'm having a trouble seeing mine. Because people are accusing me of it in my life and I don't see it. Or because I'm trying to figure out what's wrong with me. What's sin? But all of this is before Christ. I absolutely love if the verses all ended where I said they did. If they'd all stop there, we are in serious trouble. If when Adam was kicked out of the garden, that was it. We're left to our own devices until we die, and then we all turn to worm food. This is terrible. This is worthless. Our entire lives then are martyred, and there's not much reason for going on with them. If there's nothing left, if this is all there is, then what's the point of going on? But we need to understand a couple of things. That before Christ, this sin just layers on us. It just gets worse. It just keeps weighing us down. It just keeps miring us further into the muck. It just keeps stinking. There's no nicer way to put it. It just keeps stinking. And that smell just gets worse because it's just getting hotter and that meat's just rotting worse. Yeah. But after Christ, it's worse. You see, before Christ, you're swimming around in a cesspool that you don't even realize is filthy. But after Christ, you're like that 5-year-old kid in a white suit standing around a pile of mud puddles. And all of them need to be splashed in. Every one of them. That's our life now. Because James tells us, to him that knows to do good and to do not, that is sin. You see, before Christ, we were so dumb and so blind, we were splashing around in this muck, and no matter how much we splashed around, it just kept getting deeper and it just kept coating us. And we got to the point where we stopped asking, what's sin? And we started being philosophical and started asking, what is sin? And then we started getting mad when people accused us of sin because we were so blind to it all. And then it goes deeper when we meet Christ. And Christ washes us clean. And we are standing there, as it were, in fresh linens, absolutely washed white by the blood of Christ, washed clean by the blood at Calvary, washed absolutely white by the sacrifice of that perfect lamb. We have been washed clean. And when sin comes to us, we have chosen it. We have picked to splash around in it. I have chosen to lie. I have decided to be jealous. I thought that speeding was no big deal. I thought that cheating on the test was no big problem. And now when I choose it in the face of God. You see, that's part of the craziness of the story of Adam. God told him, you'll die. He wasn't ignorant of it like we are. With my kid, I've never had to teach my child to lie. They figured it out. All four of them figured it out on their own. I think the others helped. But they figured it out. And yet he had to pick. He had to choose to sin. You see, now that we've met Christ, we choose to do these things. What does it mar? What does it ruin? What does sin do? It destroys everything. But when God sees it, when we do meet Christ, here's the most beautiful thing. Thanksgiving just ended. Here's the coolest part about being dumb. That God forgives it. That he doesn't see me anymore. That all this sin splashing around that I've done, when I come in just dripping mud and I walk into the throne room of God, just completely mired again, and I plead for forgiveness. It was complete the first time. Past, present, and future, I knew them. Past, present, and future, I paid for them. Past, present, and future, I forgave them. All of them. I go to God, sometimes arguing, what sin? And then he comes to me when I'm just standing there, he wraps his arms around me and says, what sin? I see my son. Now that's not to say that it doesn't separate us, and that's a whole other discussion of what sin does about pulling us away from God, about making us filthy to where we have chosen to stay back because we have think that we have gotten so mired again that God doesn't want to be near us, and all he does is draw near to us, and we push back going, but I'm filthy again, but God draws near, but we push back, but I'm filthy again. It is us who chooses to separate ourselves from God. God wants to cleanse us again. God wants to wash that again. God wants to forgive that. God wants us to repent. God chooses these things. He says, what sin would separate you from me? I love that God is holding me in his hands despite how messy I think I am. But that's the most beautiful thing. Because I don't forget. It is the most beautiful thing in an argument you can ever have is the person who doesn't forget anything. Because my wife will argue with me and be like, that's not what you said. These are the exact words you said 7 years ago. How do you know that? Because I don't forget things. Because since I've been a young child, I can remember things that I didn't think I could remember. And there are some times where I've pled with God to let me forget things I don't want to remember. But I remember them. And I will fall again and say, God, please. I'm a liar. I've lied so many times in my life. I've lied. And I've stolen things, God. And I've been jealous, God. And I've adultered in my heart, God. And I've hated. And you know who I am. You've seen what I've been these years. And I try to dredge it all back up and take it to God. And God says, what sin? I've forgiven those. I've blotted those out. What sin? You see, from my perspective, I'm arguing with God so many times. What have I done? And then when I finally realize that I come to God, God looks at me and goes, what sin, my son? You're mine. I picked you. I chose you. Now in Micah 7:9, we get this beautiful passage about him casting his sin into the sea, and we tack on the word the sea of forgetfulness. It doesn't really say that, it just says into the sea. And in Psalm 103, we have that beautiful phrase, the casting crowns is latched onto, that says he has tossed our sin as far as the east is from the west. So has he forgiven man's transgressions. But it says, because he is merciful. I don't forget, and God already has. You see, this has been the Thanksgiving week. And for some people, this is a really bad time. And for some people, it's all about the wonderful things God has given you and all the things that are going to be there Black Friday. God has blessed us with Black Friday. But sometimes what we really need to be thankful for is that despite my arrogant arguing with God of what sin, He has already forgiven those that I have not even seen. You see, I will finish with this. I want to ask you, what sin is holding you right now? If you're sitting here and you've just never really admitted to God that you even are a sinner, there's a lot of people here that are. You're all a bunch of sinners. But me, no, I'm good. I love the testimony of Joe Murray that he was sat there for so many years looking at everyone else and saying, that guy needs it. And he finally realized it was me. It was me who needed it. It was me who needs forgiveness. Not just that alcoholic, it was me. I would ask you, what sin is holding you back? What sin? What sin is going to keep you from heaven? What sin is going to mar your family? What sin is going to destroy your ministry? What sin is going to ruin your life? What sin are you going to hold on to and let you separate from God? What sin is so pleasurable that you'd rather have it than the peace of God? What sin is so wonderful that you would trade the mercy of the Almighty Father for? What sin would you rather hold on to than have God hold on to you? What sin do you want? Don't argue with God going, what sin? Plead with God saying, what sin is holding me? I wish I had some of those friends like Job, because I'm not Job. Because there's a whole lot of things God could strike down my family for. There is a whole list of things that God could have caused sores all over my body for. There is a whole list of things that He couldn't have held back and said, God, the devil, you can't just touch him. You can't take his life. He just said, strike me down. There's a line from such a good movie that somebody's yelling at God and they yell, smite me, O great smiter. And there have been a lot of times where I've yelled that at God, if you're so powerful, do something about this because you haven't stopped me yet. This morning, I'd ask you to stand with me. We're going to pray. And I'd ask you to look real deeply at what sin. Is there one? Have you been arguing with God that there's none in you? What sin is really holding on to you? And it could be the small. I love that we call them the small ones. You know, that little lie, that's not a big deal. I haven't killed anybody. I haven't murdered anybody. I stand here at the altar going, Lord, I'm not like that man. I've never done all these things. Instead of pleading like the tax collector, have mercy on me, a sinner. Because he said to have fallen in one. It took one. If none of you had done anything wrong, one of mine put him on the cross. Just one was enough to send me to hell. So it would take just one to nail him there. And it might have been just mine. Just one could have done it. If I have fallen in one, I have fallen in all of them. Just one was enough. What sin? What sin? Let's pray together. Father, please. Father, some of the scariest times I've had with you is asking that question, what sin? And you start from the moment my feet hit the floor and show me all of the things wrong that I've done until I plead for you to stop. Father, I ask this morning that you would have that same grace on everyone, that you would just let them see what sin. What sin is holding them, Father? What sin has got dominion over them, Father? What sin is clinging to them like that muck again? What sin have they picked? And Father, please have mercy on them and wash it. Have mercy on them, Father, and take it away. Have mercy on them, Father. Grasp them again and say, what sin, my son? What sin, my daughter? For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.